Yo, I'm telling you guys right now, the feels in this episode, the absolute feels in Seven Deadly Sins, Season 2, Episode 2. I cannot believe what I was watching. So, to start off, Ban and Elaine, yo, the feels, oh my goodness. And then King, just the way that all the fairies in the Fairy King's Forest, they just despise him, they just hate him. And I'm just sitting there watching this, and I'm just trying not to cry because King just feels really bad. He doesn't know where to go. He's sad. He's alone. He feels that he's alone. But in the end, of course, he does learn that Diane, she still really, really cares about him, and she just remembered all the events that took place way back then with her and King. It's just really touching to see that. I just don't know what else to tell you guys. 10 out of 10 for this episode with the music and the feels, the absolute feeling of this episode. Love is in the air with this episode. I cannot even explain, cannot even put into words how beautiful this episode was. The very first episode was happiness and then a little taste of despair when the Ten Commandments actually, surfaced. And now this episode just completely just, wow, blew me out of the water. Breathtaking, absolutely enjoyed it. Love the fact that the Fairy King's Forest is back. When we learned that Ban planted the seed, it was all a very big shocking surprise for me. I didn't think the fairies of the Fairy King's Forest would start calling Ban the King of the Fairy King's Forest. I don't know what to say to that. And I thought it was gonna be King at first. He was greeting his friends with happiness, but then all of a sudden they're like, back off. We're talking to this guy. I'm just like, what? Who are they talking to? Is that they're talking to Ban? Like, I was shocked. Like, wow. As I said, love is in the air, and Diane really misses King, and that just really puts a hole in my chest. The way King just left like that, it truly shows who King is, what his character is like. The symbolism is real. He left Diane the first time, and then he left a second time without saying anything. That's just really heartbreaking. I gotta say though, King's reaction to when he saw his sister, oh my goodness, not even going to go deep into that, but that just really, whew, wow. Then we have Meliodas and Elizabeth, and Meliodas is very worried about her safety, so he refuses for her to come with the Seven Deadly Sins to Camelot. They're all preparing for the battle ahead, and obviously I can understand Meliodas and the way he feels. He does not want Elizabeth getting dragged into this because this is going to be one heck of a fight. And then you have the Ten Commandments, who are literally drained of energy because they've been, sealed away for, if I'm not mistaken, 3,000 years. 3,000 years is a long time. Of course, their magic energy would be sapped, but somehow they still have the strength to fly in the air, which absolutely makes zero sense to me. But then again, it just goes to show you how strong they truly are. I am truly beginning to question how strong these guys truly are, the Ten Commandments, because the way it's going, Meliodas is hiding his true feelings about this battle. It seems to me, I don't know about you guys, but it seems that he's a little on edge, on the inside, but on the outside, he's just acting very calm. You can tell he's calm, he's assessing the situation, and he's looking further into the future for answers. And also, apparently, I'm curious as to what Merlin took from Meliodas, I believe it was 10 years ago, as mentioned in episode 2. I don't know what that is. I'm very curious to know what that is because it seems to be very, very important. Let's jump back a bit. Dreyfus and Hendrickson. This person that looks like Dreyfus is definitely not Dreyfus. Dreyfus is long dead, and there is some kind of evil entity lurking within Dreyfus's body, or it's just somebody that looks like him. I'm not quite sure. I wasn't quite paying too much attention to that part, but I do know that this person looks like Dreyfus, but is not actually him. It's interesting. It's scaring me though. It really is. And then we have Gother. Something is seriously wrong with this guy. He's twisted. Like, I knew something was definitely wrong with this guy since season one. Ever since I saw him, I just had a really bad feeling. And now we're starting to see the darker side of him. He doesn't really know what it means to be a human being. He does not have a proper thought process. And what I mean by this is, you guys saw the episode. It's just nasty. It's disgusting to see the way things went down in this episode. He deleted the memories of Gwila, of her brother, and literally just replace them with, you know, memories of him and her together. And he's stating that that is love, but that's not really love. He got rid of the memories that of the one she loved, and that was her brother. And that's just truly disgusting to see. In order for this sick, twisted guy to build his relationship with Gwila, he had her brother removed from the picture. That is just, wow, what are you doing, bro? What are you doing? Obviously, we can see from this that Gother is unstable and he seriously needs help. And then again, I do remember Hawk was eating something out of a bottle and, you know, Meliodas is a bit concerned. And then Merlin's mentioning that something could be trouble for Gother. I'm guessing this has to do with Merlin and the magic stabilizing medicine that she was supposed to give Gother. So I'm guessing this guy did not take his chill pills and he's out of control right now. He seriously needs help. All of this is really good for the second episode. We have love, confusion, hate, anger, and also maybe a little bit of jealousy because Jericho has, you know, she likes Ban. That's what I'm thinking right now. Obviously she likes Ban, and the fact that Ban is holding Elaine, you can see it in her eyes. She's jealous. She doesn't know what is going on. She doesn't know what to say. And frankly, Ban does not care about her. Ban only has one goal, one purpose right now, and that is to revive Elaine from the dead. So I really gotta say it, this episode again was 10 out of 10 in my book. I'm not picky with anything thus far. I did see the opening for the ending of the last episode. Really gotta say, splendid. I love Grand Rodeo. I do remember them from Kuroko no Basket. They played all the openings for Kuroko. And it's really good to see them playing for Seven Deadly Sins. It's really cool, I gotta say. And the ending was also fantastic, phenomenal. It was very soft. It was beautiful to see. And one more thing, if I might add, before I close. Helbram and the fact that his soul is attached to King's helmet. That is really touching. All because Elaine asked Helbram to look after King. What a very astonishing episode. I cannot wait for episode 3. If you guys really enjoyed the episode, please let me know how you felt about it in the comments. I'd love to see your comments on that. And I will see you in the next Seven Deadly Sins review. Peace out.